Hello, coders. Good morning.
Why is this so low?
Oh. This is so low for some reason. I hope you're well. It is Tuesday. And today we're going to take a bit of a sidestep. And we're not going to do the APIs. We're not going to do the how to code well platform today. Today, what we're going to do instead is we're going to look at an e-commerce platform. So just give you a bit of background. So I'm a freelance developer, and I've been asked to produce a couple of e-com sites, and I'm allowed to discuss and demonstrate the build on stream, but I can't obviously talk about the clients themselves and the products that they're going to be selling and all of that stuff. So it's going to be very generic, very white label, very vanilla. And last night on the Discord server, we were talking about in the community channel, we were talking about what kind of e-commerce platforms we work with. And I think Drupal Ecom Project was floated around, and Shopify, and I was discussing like possibly using WooCommerce and all of that stuff. And then a thought occurred to me last night. Why don't I test out Silas? Is it Silas? I think that's the right pronunciation. So I've used Silas before, but we're talking about 3 years ago when it wasn't even in version one. It was like a very old version or a new version, and it was being changed very, very frequently. In fact, I helped write some of the README, and also I fixed a couple of PRs, but nothing major. I think it was mostly to do with the taxonomy stuff. Nothing major. I'm not even going to consider knowing anything about Silas, so this is a complete blank slate. So what I would like to do today in today's stream is to install it and just try it out in a very sort of generic manner. Just see what it can and can't do. And yeah, just see how quick I can get it up, spinning up, running, up and running, and configured. So we're in my, if I go into here, we're in my, in the terminal here. So we're in the templates folder on my local machine. And essentially what I want to do is create a Silas template or an installer. So the first thing we should do really, because this is a bit of an R&D stream, is to actually go and take a look at the documentation, which I've been fiddling about with already this morning. So the installation of Silas, the main application can serve as an end user app as well as a foundation for your custom e-commerce application. Awesome. To create your Silas-based application, first make sure that you have PHP 7.3 or higher and have Composer installed. Now, I'm a Docker fanboy, as everybody knows. We're going to use Docker. Plain and simple. So I'm not too fussed about that, but I'm glad that it's on PHP 7.3. That's good to know. In order to inform you about Silas releases, please be aware. Okay, fine. Don't worry about that. It's just a little note. Okay, this is the good stuff. So to begin creating your project, run this command: Composer create project Silas standard, and then the project name, which is Acme. Make sure to use the PHP 7.3. Make sure to use PHP 7.3. Using an older PHP version results in installing an older version of Silas. Makes sense. This will create a new Symfony project in the Acme directory. Next, move to that directory. Okay, so that's cool. It's documented really nice. This is a step up from what it was about 3 years ago. Silas uses environment variables to configure connection with database and mailer services. You can look up, okay, so it's using a .env file, which is all good. And then you can customize it by creating a .env.local file, fine. Okay, once this is done, you configure your database, which is MySQL, which is good. And then after everything is in place, run the following command, which is Silas install. Now, I used to call this Silius, but perhaps it's Silas. Ah, dear. Hello, Tyranid. Thank you very much for joining today. So I hope you're doing well. I've got a little bit of a croaky throat and a bit of a fuzzy head because yesterday, of course, was my birthday, you know, I had a little bit of a birthday drink. So I'm on the fluids today, definitely. Lots of cups of teas this morning. During the Silas install command, you will be asked to provide important information, but it is its execution ensures that the default currency USD and the default locale English US are set. They can be changed later respectfully in the configuration channels section of the admin. Yada yada yada. And then here, installing assets, so we're using Yarn to do that, and then accessing the shop here's the way of doing that. Okay, so we're certainly not down that yet. So let's see what we need to start with. Silas plus Symfony plus Docker plus Ghost plus AWS plus Terraform plus Ansible. None of this is for HTCW, right? So none of this is for how to code well. This is just for me playing around with something that I could be using for a potential set of clients. They've given me the permission to do the build of this on stream, but I'm not allowed to discuss what they do, obviously, and their products. So this is a complete and utter R&D stream. It's got nothing to do with how to code well. The actual platform that we're building is totally different, a total sidestep. And I think it's actually quite nice to diversify from time to time. The project is going okay, by the way. I was doing with a little bit of it yesterday, and it's going in a good direction. I think reducing the amount of complexities regarding with the microservices is helping tremendously, so that's good. So I will pick that up again on Sunday, I think. But today I just want to kind of take a sidestep and look into Silas and just see what you can and can't do with it. And we're going to try and build some sort of installer for Silas, or a template for Silas that I can fork and use for other projects. And of course, it's going to be done in Docker, because that's what I do. So it will be Silas plus Docker. okay, so to run it, we use Composer Create Project Silas, and then the Silas standard. But is that going to pull down all the files needed, including the Docker Compose file that I'm sure they have? Let me just see. Can I edit on GitHub, Silas demo? Is there a link to the actual GitHub repo? Or am I going to need to find that? Let's see if I can do that. So it was Silas standard. Standard RD and GitHub. Here we go. So this is essentially what we're going to pull down, I'm assuming, and it does have a Docker Compose and Docker Compose.prod. It's a shame that I can't find anything in the documentation at this stage. There might be later on, of course, about installing it with Docker. I can't see anything in here yet. Let's see if I can get to the cookbook. Sometimes there's something in here. No, this is going talking about entities and APIs and all this stuff. All right, let's not come off of the path too much. Let's go down to, yeah, just go getting started. Install. All right. Okay, so the first thing I need to do is make sure that I have PHP 7.2, I believe, installed. Or did it say 7.3 installed? So we'll take a look at that. PHP hyphen V, what have I got? 7.3, boom. Okay, that's good. Okay, so let's... I'm on a different page than what I was before. Where did I start from? Getting started with Silas. Installation. Meh. Okay, I'm sure that said Acme before. So I'm not too sure where. Let's start from the beginning. Installation. I'm sure that was Acme before. Anyway, let's just run this. So composer create Silas. We're going to just do my first shop. Yeah, why not? What's the worst that can happen, right? So it's I wish there was a loading bar or something to give me any kind of indication that it's doing something, because this is here we go. Woo! Okay, your requirements can't be resolved. The problem here is that it's requiring EX if the requested PHP extension is missing from the system. So I can't remember for the life of me, am I using Mac ports or am I using Homebrew? I think because it's opt local, it's Homebrew rather than Mac ports. So let's see if we can install that. So PHP, I know that I did say that we're going to do everything in Docker, which we will, but let's first get this running first on the host machine, first of all. Because essentially I want to get hold of that Docker compose file. So, right, so this is exif. So so it is home, it's brew install PHP, I think it's just PHP 7.3, I think this is right, exif. That's a bit annoying. Please don't talk over me. That's better. Right. I don't know if this is the right command, of course. This could be completely wrong. I don't actually know what that is, to be honest. Let's go. What is that? What am I installing on my system? What's going on? So that's definitely the way to do it, to install the CMD. It seems to be something to do with graphics. Meh. Come on, Homebrew. How frustrating. Okay, something's happening. Here we go. No available formula. Brilliant. Brilliant. If don't you just love how things just go from like I want to install Cilius today, now I need to install exif. Brilliant. Could it just be that PHP exif? No. Homebrew PHP cannot install any package, so it's plek. Ugh. Must include exif. Oh man, this is annoying. PHP hyphen M. No, it's not there. Damn. Oh, this is so frustrating. Brew install. Sorry about all this. Thank you. I'm now doubting myself as to where user bin. PHP any ops local ports. Could it be that port install port select list PHP? That's pip, sorry, PHP. Active. Okay, sorry, I'm using Mac ports and not homebrew. Silly me. So it's port install PHP 7.3 xif, I think. And of course I need to do that sudo. We'll get there in the end. Come on. Yay, attempting to fetch, scanning, no files found, no broken ports found. Does this mean activating cleaning? So it does mean that we've got it installed. PHP hyphen M. Exif, woohoo! Okay, so sorry about all of that. Let's see if we can get reverse search back into Composer. My first shop. Have you actually done anything? Yes, you have. Let's do an rm minus rv and remove all of this stuff. Yeah, of course I'm in the wrong directory. In anyway, I should be in this directory. Jeez. Composer create, right. Yay. Okay. Sorry about all of that. you know how these streams go. I have such a great idea of doing such and such, and then it all goes a little bit wrong because I don't have things installed, and it's just the way of the developer life, unfortunately. And then you can't remember how you've installed or configured your system. Thank you everyone for all the birthday wishes yesterday. That was super, super cool. Thank you very much. I do appreciate it. I had a really good day yesterday. It was good. I had it was technically a working day because it was, you know, Monday and everything, but I managed to avoid meetings, which was great. So I had a whole day to just myself, which was nice. Excellent. This seems to be running through good. Okay, algorithm is not available. Either use auto. What? What? I've never seen this before. Algorithm argon2i is not available. Either use auto or upgrade to PHP 7.2 plus instead. Well, we're running PHP-V. 7.3. What on earth does this mean? Oh dear. Right, let's Google that. So far, this has been a little painful, but I think it's down to the configuration of my machine and not Silas itself. What on earth does this mean? Okay. So it's something to do with the security, okay. Can you specify the version of PHP, PHP 7.2 without lib sodium? I don't know why. Okay, so there is at least two good algorithm options here, bcrypt or argon2i. The argon2i encoder is actually a bit more secure, but it's only available in PHP 7.2 by installing an extension called sodium. This issue has automatically been marked as stale because it has had not any recent activity, yada yada yada. Okay, so this is someone using 7.3. I had the same problem on 7.2 and 7.3, both sodium enabled. And you can easily change it to be okay, fine. So you just change the encoder. I gotcha. Okay. If for some reason you cannot use argon2 algorithm, you can override the Silas hidden configuration by changing the encoder in all this stuff. Okay, so I could try that at least. This person's using SHA-5512. I think for speed, I'm going to change this to Bcrypt, I think. So this would be in, if we loaded up PHP Storm here, we should have my first shop. And then in here, we should have, there's the Docker files. Hello. We should have a config file in packages in security.yml. And there should be something in here about the encoder somewhere. Encoders, here we go. Let's change that to this one. Okay, right. Let's see if we can do a, not a create project, because that'll do that again. Let's do let's go into the directory itself. And let's do composer install, update, sorry, no, install. And just make sure that we have a clean installation. No, what's going on here? I've just changed it to Bcrypt, and this is now still complaining. What? That's not right. Unless I need to do that somewhere else. Let's do a find in path and find that. No, that is the only sole place. Although it's in spec. That's security.yml. That's security.yml. This is the ignored file, which lives in vendor. Well, that's a frustrating. Hang on a minute. Hold on. Right, now it's... okay, this is a little bit of a hack, isn't it? So the interface is Bcrypt, and then we change argon2i to Bcrypt. All right, let's see if we can do that. I didn't do that. I just changed the interface. So you want me to change the interface, and you also want me to, add that bit in as well. Which I just think is a bit dirty, but okay. I'm not even going to attempt to try and install this on this machine. We might be doing this, eventually I want to do this in Docker, so we'll have full control over the image. I hope. I just want to get this cleanly installed on the machine, so then we've got access to these files here, the Docker Compose and Docker Compose prod files. Okay, this looks good. It seems to be going through okay. Okay, I spoke too soon. Let's scroll up. Oh, God darn it. This is a memory issue. Seriously. A memory issue. Oh, man. Okay. Okay. I'm not even running this in Docker, so I don't actually have... I'm not running this in a VM. This is just running straight off of my host machine. But I would imagine that there's a problem with my PHP memory size. I mean, that's a big size anyway. But, let me just run that again and just see. Composer install... I do think I'm going to have adjust that. Great. All right. Let me... yikes. PHP update memory limit. I can never remember. It's in the ini file somewhere, but it's always nice to have increase the memory limit. Here we go. In your ini file. There we go. Memory limit to that. Yeah. All right. Let's dig this out. PHP hyphen ini to see where the ini files live. They live in here. So let's go and grab scan for additional ini files in that directory. var/db. Okay. So it's this one here. Okay, so let's do a VI of that. All right, so let's now take a look and see. Somewhere in here is going to be memory limit. Memory limit, memory limit. Error handling. Display errors are on. Log errors are on, that's good. Register. Production values, this is all fine. Apparently I went past it, so I'm going back up. Ignore errors, display startup errors, error reporting, error. Here we go. So, oh wow, that's low. So no wonder it was having problems. Okay. So let's okay. So let's just say on stream that all of these issues that I've faced have been to do with my setup, not Silas. okay, I'm going to increase this to 2 gigs. 2 Gs. Is it? Can I do that? 2 GBs? Do I have to do 2? I think that's correct, but I just want to make sure that I can do this. If it's... Yeah, 2G, not GB. Okay. Have you tried using it in MB? That's what I wanted to do. Let's do 20. Let's do that instead. So 2048 MB. There we go. Cool. That looks good. All right. Let's come out of this. Right and quit. What? What? Exclamation mark, write and quit. Enter to return to the command. Okay, that's good. Okay, cool. Q. Ah! Vim, what are you doing? Leave me alone. There we go. No! God damn it. QA. Why is it returning? This is weird. No writes since last change. Press enter or type a command to continue. What? QA. I should have used nano. I should have used nano. Yeah, I didn't sudo it, and it should have been sudoed. Damn. But I can't seem to get out of... I can't seem to get out of this loop. I'll hack it. There we go. Let's do nano, because it's too early in the morning to deal with Vim. Sudo nano. Too early in the morning for that stuff. All right, so we want to do a search for memory limit. Come on. Right, let's change this to 2048 MB. Sorry. 2000 gigabytes, please. No, thank you. Okay, let's come out of this. So, yep. Change the all those things. Thank you. Thank you. I want to just double check that that has been set. So let's do cat of OPT local blah 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 PHP .ini 73 etc db. No, that's wrong. etc PHP 73. I'm sure it has been, but I just want to double check. And then PHP pipe to grep memory. Two. There we go. Gotcha. Good. Okay. Right. Let's get back into the directory that I was in, which is in PFWD templates, I think. Yep, and there we go. And my, yep, ls. Okay, I'm just gonna make this a little bit smaller just so I can put it on fully on stream. Because I think it's the follower goal thing is in the way. So let's clear that down a mo. So we're in here, and we should now hopefully be able to do composer install again. Hopefully. Oh, come on. Seriously? Allowed memory size. Try to allocate. I've just done it. I've literally just said it. Unless I need to restart anything. Ah, man. All right, let's get back to so probably not with a B, right? Just M, because that's got no B. That's got no B. Okay, let's try that. Oh, this is looking better. I will get there. Perseverance. Vim may have won. But I said it with Nano. My excuse, this is my first cup of tea this morning. So I don't have the patience to deal with getting stuck in a Vim exit loop. Okay, that ran. That's what I wanted, a clean output. Wonderful, good stuff. Good. Okay, let's take a look at the Docker stuff. Quickly. Well, actually, before we get that, let's continue walking down this. This is all we've ran. Okay, then it will create my first shot, which is done. You then do bin Silas install. Tell you what, let's just run this and see. Well, it's gonna complain that we don't have a database. Yeah, that's just not going to work, is it? Because I don't have a DB. I could create a DB locally. Do I want to do that, though? Let's just try it and see what blows up. All right, here we go. Some system requirements are not fulfilled. Please check the messages and fix them. Okay, so scroll up to the top here. What have we got? Time zone is erroring. PHP version is correct. That's good. But we don't have a time zone set. Something to do with accelerator. We got a warning on that. Scroll down here. We've got the time zones. That can be done in the .ini file. So let's see if we can do that. Just copy that and then do a sudo of that file again. And then do a search for date.timezone. Yeah, it's not even set. They did suggest something, didn't they? They suggested Amsterdam. I think, though, I should. Let me see. Let me just get that. I think I should be able to do Europe, London, but let's just double check that. List of supported time zones. Europe. Yeah, I can. I thought I could. What's this? You're about to paste a string with tabs. Cancel. Yeah. That's all right. I'll just remove them. There you go. Okay. So let's come out of this. Yep. Let's try that again. Okay, here we go. So yeah, it is going to blow up because we don't have a DB. But all the bits and pieces are running. We have an issue with the accelerator. Again, I'm not overly worried about this because it's locally, right? It's on my local machine. Creating Solus database for dev environment. Now we're seeing it, obviously, we've got a DB connection refused going on here. So let me just take a look at the Docker file. So we've got here docker-compose.yaml. Let's just see what are we going to do here. So we create a build. The target is Solus. I keep saying Solus. Solus PHP, which would be, where would that be? And then the cache from. Okay. So that's the getting some cache info. Okay, then running off of the image PHP latest. So this is getting PHP q.io. Depends on MySQL. We've got some environment variables here. This is the database URL. We also use something called mailhog. And then this is something to do with setting up the PHP date time zone as well. Okay, so then now we've got some volumes. If you develop on Linux, you may use a bind mounted host directory instead, something like this. But this is current working directory to srv Solus. And then we've got another two more. This is Docker volume, of course, public media, which should be defined somewhere in the volumes. Here we go. Okay. Okay, so that's not so bad. Okay, so then we got the database here running for 5.7. And then we got Node.js because we obviously need to use Yarn and everything. And then we got the web server itself, which is Nginx. I'm going to give this a whirl, I think. I'm going to give this a whirl. But I think what I need to do before I, because I've got other projects and stuff running, I think what I need to do, first of all, is create myself a Docker machine. If I've got, do I have machine running on here? No, of course I don't. Of course I don't have Docker machine running on here. Right. Because what I want to do is create myself a Docker machine just to put this in. Bear with me whilst I have a look at my setup for Docker a minute. Documentation, preferences, check for updates. Okay, here we go, Docker engine. All right, that's not going to give me any information that I need. Let's just go ahead and install it, I think. So let's go over to here and then type install Docker machine. I think what happens annoyingly is when you install and when you update Docker on Mac, if it knows that you've got Docker machine installed, in the recent cases at least, it has been removing Docker machine, which is so frustrating. Installing Docker, so install Docker machine. If you're using Linux, if you're running Windows, if you're using macOS, there we go. Right, let's do this in here. The reason why I want to put this in a Docker machine is because I don't want it to screw around with the other containers that I've got. That's essentially it, really. So what we're doing is we're downloading Docker machine, which is the command line tool to actually create Docker machines. Okay, good. It's done. So up here, we'll do Docker machine create, and we'll do coming up with just word sounds now. I want to create Silas template. There we go. All right, so essentially what we're doing is we're spinning up a little VM that it has Docker installed, the Docker engine installed, which means that, well, if I was to show you VirtualBox, which I won't because there's various other machines on there which I don't want to show, but if I was to show you VirtualBox, it would show you that there is a new VM that's created called Silas template, and it's a very small, lightweight VM which has the Docker engine installed. And then what you do is there's a command that marries up your command line, your prompt, to the virtual machine. So you're then using the environment variables on the VM. So then when you run Docker Compose, you're then installing all the bits and pieces within the VM, not on your local machine. It's what I use quite frequently to carve portions of my machine for various different projects. I just know that I'm going to get into a world of pain when I start doing various bits and pieces, especially with the databases and all sorts. So, okay, so this is now installed and I can run Docker machine env Silas template, which will get the environment variables of this machine. So it's running off of this IP 192.168.99.137. And then I run this little special command here, which is evaluating these environment variables to this machine, to this prompt, sorry. Not that command, that's ridiculous. This command here. There we go. Okay, so if I did docker ps hyphen a, it should be completely and utterly empty. However, down here, if I did docker ps hyphen a, because we're not connected to the Docker machine, we will get all of the containers for the How to Code Well project. Okay, so up here we're working in our VM. Okay, so so it means every terminal window I use, I need to run that command. Anyway, we won't need that for now, so we'll just work within here. Hello, is it Shaytu Amon? Thank you very much for following. I do appreciate that. You've gone and set off the emotes. There's an emote explosion going off right now. Thank you very much for following. And whilst I'm on the subject, I also want to just thank all the people who followed yesterday. Even though there wasn't a stream yesterday, I do appreciate everybody following. So we'll go down the list. Let's start from the Samkin. Pawnbase, Jono411, Verbrenosher1974, and of course, Shitu Amon. Thank you very much for following. I do appreciate it. Thank you very much. Yesterday was my birthday, which was, so it's really nice to see all of this, which is awesome. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Today, what we're going to do is, what we're playing with is Silas, which is an e-commerce symphony frame platform. I have used it previously in the past, but that was like 3 years ago. I haven't used it since. I'm a freelancer, and I've got some clients who are interested in creating a e-commerce shop, and they've said that I can do the build on stream, the actual research and development stuff on stream, but I can't obviously talk about what they do, obviously. So I'm just trying to get Silas installed at the moment. I'm a Docker fanboy. I've done a couple of courses in Docker, so we're running this in Docker. I've just recently just spun up a Docker machine for this to go in. And what we're going to do, Silas, the standard edition, has Docker Compose in docker-compose.yml here. So we're going to run this, and we'll just see what happens, right? We'll just see what happens. So if we did Docker hyphen compose, let's do up hyphen D hyphen hyphen build. Now, I haven't seen anywhere in the documentation, I should say this, of how to do this in Docker. It kind of only talks about the running it through Composer. So, I mean, it could be later on, like an advanced chapter or something like this, but I haven't seen it so far. So all of this, what I'm doing now, is not documented as far as I can tell. So we're going off book. Let's run this. Okay, so this is going to build what is this doing? This is installing the database. The reason why it's doing the database first is because it knows that the PHP depends, I think there's depends, on MySQL. So it runs it top down, it knows that PHP depends on MySQL, so it's going to run MySQL. MySQL doesn't depend on anything else, so it'll just do that. It'll run that, and then it'll probably run this, and then it'll continue down, which will install Node.js, and then Nginx afterwards. So yeah, it knows that Nginx depends on PHP and Node.js, so that would be once those two things are installed. And then it'll probably do mail hog last. So let's go and have a little look. This is probably going to take a little bit of time, so I'll waffle on. So normally what I do on these streams is that I normally do the build the new How to Code Well platform. I've done 17 courses now, totally free on YouTube. And the How to Code Well platform will be hosting those, the new platform. And there's going to be a free tier and a subscription tier. Subscription tier will allow you to have access to the content, but without any adverts. And also, I'm going to be doing premium. There is premium. I should say I've done courses that are premium courses on things like Udemy and Skillshare and all that jazz. So they'll be on there too, but only for the subscription-based customers. So for the past, I don't know, what, a couple of years, we've been working through that project, and I've taken all sorts of different routes and everything. Lots of mistakes have been made along the way. A lot of inward thinking, I think, recently at least. We tried to do it all in microservices, and it just basically, it just has taken a long time to do all of that. So what I've recently done is I've combined some of the microservices into a single monolith. And I think that's probably one of the best decisions I've made in this project at the moment. So we have an e-learning service. We've got a user service and an auth service. I've kind of basically combined them. We've got other services such as an order service and subscription service that I haven't actually shown on stream yet. They are still in their microservices world. And what I was doing yesterday for a bit yesterday is I was coming up with some of the API endpoints. The front end is in Gatsby, which has been fun to build. What we'll do on Sunday, I think, although let me just double check the calendar, bear with me a second. I'll have to do this off stream. Yeah, let me get back to you on that, but I think on Sunday we'll do that. Let's have a look. We want to look for... And the reason why I'm checking the calendar is that on the last Sunday of every month, come on, month view. Yeah, okay, so next weekend, we're gonna do the stream to do with how to code well, the microservices and stuff. And then on the 3rd of May, we're going to do the coding challenge. On the 3rd of May. You heard it here first. So the coding challenge, I'll talk about this whilst this is going through. The coding challenge, if I find it, it is codingchallenges.howtocodewell.net. This is a little challenge that we do every month. And it's at the moment we're building a little game in JavaScript. And you can become a member on the Discord server. It's totally free to be a member. There's a nice community of developers there who are happy to answer and ask questions. And what I've got is a channel on the Discord server called Coding Challenges. And every month, people submit their challenge to that channel, the Coding Challenges channel, and I review them live on stream. This is what we're going to do on the 3rd of May. And this is the second part of the challenge. And it's creating a game. So if you want to join the Discord server, then please do so. So I'll put that link in the chat here. And I'll also put the Coding Challenges website in as well. We've got we've just reached over 200 members in the Discord server, which is fantastic. So thank you ever so much, everybody, for joining. It's turning out to be a really nice, great place. It's great. I love it. A place to hang out and chill out with devs from all over the world. The How to Code Well community is growing. Of course, there is the How to Code Well YouTube channel as well. So that is here, so YouTube. And this is where I put all of my tutorials. And of course, we do have a podcast that happens every Friday, and that's videoed that's videoed, and the audio goes to the podcast players, so you can get it on Spotify, you can get it on iTunes and Google podcast players, but you can also watch the interview on YouTube as well. If you just want to listen to it, then, or if you want to see the previous episodes, then go to howtocodewell.fm/podcast. There we go, and you can check that out. Last Friday, we had a super interesting chat with Emily Wallace Price, with her super interesting career change. She was a care worker for 10 years, but due to health reasons, she had to switch jobs, and she's become a Laravel self-taught developer, and she is now working in her second job, her second development job, doing that, which is, so it's just such been such an interesting conversation. And there's all sorts of other things as well to do with the different types of technologies that she's been working on as well, which has been cool. So that's kind of like how those conversations go. It's kind of, I get the background information of the developers who come on, which is great to hear all of their dev stories. So let me just take a look and see how this is going. So this seems to be going through the PHP stuff, I think. This is now running Composer. Ah, this is nice. It's using, this looks like it's using multi-stage builds. So here we've got copy from. That's nice. All right, so that's now doing the Composer stuff. And down here we are doing the install, getting all the dependencies. That's a whole bunch of deprecation warnings. And now we're doing the cache clear. So essentially what I was doing locally. Okay, my cup of tea has gone incredibly cold. So what I'm going to do is pop down and get a fresh one. And I'll let this go. And hopefully install. It's now doing Node. So I will be back very, very shortly. Just going to make a cup of tea. Whoa. Okay. So that looks like, oh, get back to this view. That looks like it's done. So if we did docker ps hyphen a, we should see that we have these containers running. We've got, what have we got here? Let's see. We've got my first shop nginx1, node.js1, php1, mailhog1, and mysql1. Wonderful. If I did docker machine IP of Silas, whatever it's called, Silas template. I can never pronounce that, Silas template. That is the IP address. So if we went to that IP, we should see it running on port 8. Ooh, no, that's not right. Okay, so do we have Nginx on here? We do. All right, let me see what's this. Nginx is running off of port 88, port 80. That's fine. I wonder if I need to configure anything in the to do it from Nginx port 80. I wonder if I need to do anything to do with the vhost. So let me see. Dot public, which is here, is running. So media bundles index.php. All right, that's weird. So first of all, let's do docker logs minus f of the nginx container. All right, so we've got an upstream fast CGI job. Okay, that seems to be okay. Let's see if we can. Still coming back with a 502. Is there anything in the log files? Yes. So connection refused, failed whilst connecting to upstream client. Upstream fast CGI. All right. Is there any way I can see? Is there any kind of configuration here that I can use? It doesn't look like it. That's annoying. I was hoping to get like an nginx.conf file that I could play with. All right, let's get into it. Let's actually get into the container and have a little nosy around. So it can't connect to the upstream. This is looking like it's using the PHP FMP, FPM, sorry. Because that's port 9000, which is what it uses. So, that's a shame. I was kind of hoping that it would just spin up and have done. Okay. Docker exe, well, yeah, docker compose, we'll do it through compose. Compose exec hyphen nginx, I think. Is that what it's called? Nginx, yep, nginx. And we'll go in as bash. Okay, nope, okay, perhaps not. We'll go in as sh, maybe. Okay, good. So we're there. We're now on the container. I want to see if I can get into etc nginx ls. There should be a conf, yep, conf.d ls. Default.conf, let's cat that, default. And let's see what it's doing. So we scroll up here. So this is the problem. Well, this is what's happening. So we have anything from index.php. We are using fast CGI pass on port to the PHP service on port 9000. Comment the next line and then comment the next line to enable dynamic resolution and compatible with Kubernetes. Right, set upstream host to PHP fast CGI is upstream host, which is essentially PHP, which is what this does, right? This is the Docker resolution, I think. Right, what we'll do is we will grab this file and we will try and hack around with it a little bit. When you are using symlinks to link the document root, the current version of your application, you should pass the real application path instead of the path that you're symlinking to PHPFPM. Otherwise, PHP's op cache may not... Okay, fine. Fine. But essentially, this is the issue. So let's see if we can just put something in very quickly just to see if it will work. So we'll do nginx.conf. Essentially what I want is something that I can just play with. So we'll paste that in. We need to paste the whole thing. Let's grab all of that. Thank you. All right. So this isn't going to work. I think what I need to do is pass in, do this instead, because this is the resolver going back to the Docker, going back to Docker. So I think that should hopefully work. Now I need to obviously hack up the Docker Compose file here. So what I need to do is pass that in as a volume. Whoops. So this is dot, and this would be nginx.conf, dot slash, obviously. And that would be going back to etc forward slash nginx forward slash conf. Where did that go? Conf.d? Yeah, conf.d. Conf.d forward slash, and it was it default.conf. There we go, default.conf. Okay, conf. Okay, let's move that there. Nginx, so that's going to get the Nginx file that we've just created, which is this one here, and it's going to then put it into nginx.conf. Default.conf, okay, with the commented out changes here. Right, let's hit save. Let's now come out of this container and let's do docker compose up hyphen d. So that should hopefully bring it back up, recreating the shop. So if we go back over to here and refresh the page, what happens? Something's happening. It's still happening. Something's still happening. It's spinning around. There's something going on. Come on. Okay, whilst this is happening, I'll tell the logs. Let's do a reverse search to Docker logs. There we go. Okay, so something's going through. Oh, we've got a 500 error. We have, we certainly do have a Symfony error here, the Symfony output. So an exception has occurred during the rendering of a template. Channel could not be found. You could use the web debug toolbar to switch between channels in development. Okay. That doesn't make any sense to me. I think what's happening though is I've totally skipped the whole Silas install. I've just ran this through Docker Compose thinking that it's just going to run. I think what I need to do is I think I need to go on to the container for this. This is the thing that is missing from the documentation from what I can see. So I think we need to go into here. So I think we need to go into this, come out of this shell. Actually, let's just tail those logs. No, let's not bother with that. we're tailing the wrong logs to begin with. Let's do Docker compose. So I think what I need to do is I need to jump onto the PHP container, which is PHP as, do we have bash? No. Do we have SH? Yes. And I think I need to run bin, not nom, even though I'm hungry, bin. I think I need to run Silas install, I think. Let's first of all run console, because that's what essentially what I tried to do or locally, and it just fell apart. So, root is not resolvable. many errors. So if we go back to the installation guide here, this is running locally, and this is the what you would do next. So let's just see if we can get that running. Oops. I'm sure Silas devs will be like, what are you doing? This is the wrong way. Okay, here we go. Warning, this action will erase your database. Well, I don't have a database, so knock yourself out. Warning, this action... Well, I thought I already erased my database before, so we'll do it again, shall we? Okay, so now we're creating the public media image. So I think what would be nice, and I might see if I can, if I've got time to create a PR for the documentation here, is to go through step by step on how to actually install this via Docker. If they haven't done so already, I'm only going through this sort of installation guide. There might be some sort of advanced section somewhere that I haven't seen. I don't know. Okay, this is... Okay, here we go. Okay, do I want USD currency? Not really, but apparently I can change it later on, and apparently I can change that later on as well. What's my email address? We're going to do test at foobar.com. What's my username? We'll put in PFWD. What's my password? We're going to do test 123. Confirm that. Okay, now it's successful and I can access it apparently on slash root. So if we go back to here and then refresh this exception. So if we go back to that and then press enter. Fingers crossed now. Everybody got their fingers crossed. Am I still tailing the logs? No, I'm not. Well, this is nice and fast, isn't it? Come on. Just call me Impatient Pete. That's probably what my nickname should be. I'm sure I've got other worse nicknames than that.
Hello, coders.
Ah, sweet. All the emojis are going off again. Woo! Thank you very much. Oh, gosh, your username. Kremlin Man. Thank you very much for following. I do appreciate it. We have the Silas shop running. Woo! It's taken an hour and 16 minutes. However, we got into some mucky water with my system not being configured properly. And then we changed direction and we actually installed it through PHP, Docker. and I couldn't find any documentation on how to do that, so we basically made it up. And we hacked around with some of the Nginx config. This is all coming through experience. So we now have Silas running. This is cool. And, the images have just appeared. Okay, nice. Oh, sweet, we got a carousel as well. Out of the box. So I must say that we have used experience with dealing with painful stuff. Yeah, well, if it's not painful, it's not fun, is it? Definitely. Experience through painful stuff. If someone says to me there's a problem with the upstream, I know kind of now through the microservices whereabouts this is kind of needs to be, which is the resolver. That, by the way, I should say is the resolver of Docker. So this will resolve to Docker, which will then use the Docker networking correctly and know that PHP is the right stream to use. Learning that took me probably the best part of a week of pulling my hair out, trying to work through the microservices that we were playing with not so long ago. with the gateways. But anyway, this is cool. I like this. Let's have a little click about, shall we? So we got t-shirts, men. So one thing I should say, speed is not the greatest here. However, I'm running this on a Docker machine that I've just created, and I haven't configured at all the PHP memory limits or anything out like that. It's just literally coming out of the box. So, come on. come on. Here we go. Right, where are the images? You gonna show the images? It's still spinning around. We'll do a test. Once this works, we'll go back to the homepage and then come back to this and see if this is cached. Come on. And I guess what you would do if you were to put this into production is you would warm up the cache before all of this. I am running in dev mode, and you can see that it is, my memory limit is 128 megs and the peak is 52. Okay. So what I could do, of course, is I could tinker with the PHP ini file, which goes into the PHP FPM, but I won't play with that too much. Okay, so there we got these three. This is cool. Right, let's go back to the homepage a minute. So clicking on here. I was hoping that would be a bit faster. Okay. I'm starting to think that my configuration for PHP is too small. But really, what I want to do now we've got this running, is I want to go into the... Okay, so that ran and all the images are up. Okay. The thing that's taking time, of course, is the debugger, which hasn't displayed yet. There we go, now it's displayed. Okay, so the memory usage went down a little bit there, 38 megs. All right, let's go back to t-shirts, men. So what I want to play with is the back end of this, because this is really important. Yeah, that's quite a load time, isn't it? Yeah, total time. Woo! And of course, as Tiernan has just pointed out, in dev world, there's no caching. So it's gonna be super slow. But it's good to know that these images are up and running. So, as I mentioned before, I'm a freelance dev, and some of the clients that I've got have asked for an e-commerce solution, and I can't obviously talk about what they're doing, what they're selling on stream here, but I am allowed to discuss the build process, and we're basically using the stream as an R&D stream to do a bit of research and development into Silas, which I have used before, but that was like 3 years ago. It runs off of Symfony, which is like my favorite framework for PHP at the moment. it's really between Symfony and Laravel, but Symfony is probably my favorite. So that's a win, because I know Symfony. One thing I need to do, though, is I need to get into the back end, and I need to see how I can configure it, because there are some requirements that I need to fulfill for configuration-wise. So let's see. There should be, in the documentation here, there should be a link somewhere, I would assume, for the back end. Yes, so this is... launching the application. For testing reasons, the fastest way to start the application is using Symfony binary. It can be downloaded from, Symfony serve, whatever. That looks like the admin direction here. Let's click on next and see. So it might be just slash admin. All right, maybe it is. Let's go back here. It's slash admin. I'm running off of port 8000. That doesn't make any sense. Why would it be running off of 8000? Let's do docker ps-a. We should see what we've got here. That's just running off of port 80. There's no 8000 in here. So MailHog is running on 8025. But that's 80. So I don't know why that is set to 8000. Unless this is something to do with the Symfony serve stuff. But anyway, we'll see if we can get to slash admin. It's that tab. Because I want to have a little noodle about with the admin side. And I've got to remember what my username and password is that I set in config. Which I think is pfwd test 123, I think. Come on. Yes, okay, so let's see if I can remember what all of this was. Was it that? Come on. Let's get rid of some of these tabs. Definitely. Yep. Config dev dot YAML says when debug is on, cache files are dynamically rebuilt on each request. This is what is causing the slow speed. Yep. I wonder if we can mimic this then in another mode. So in was it in Docker Compose? I forget. There was some setting. Here we go. Dev mode. So if we were to change this from dev to something else, say prod, let's see what we got here. .env prod, .env test. So these are the environments. So if we were to change this to say .prod, then we would have, it should be faster, I hope. Okay, so this is the dashboard. I think what I'm going to do, just for my own sanity and the sanity of the stream, is we'll see if we can do this without debug on, all right? Because this is gruelingly slow. So let's tinker with this .compose file. Let's change that to be prod. Now this might just blow everything up, to be honest. App debug to 0. And let's see if we can do a Docker. We need to bring the containers down, Docker Compose down. Why not just disable debug? So if that was on dev, you mean just set this, whoops, sorry, what have I pressed Control V on? That's fine. So set this to dev and set that to zero. Yeah, all right, let's try that first. That's probably the safer route, right? So let's do Docker compose down. And then let's do Docker compose up hyphen D. I probably could have just done a restart, but I like to take things down and bring them back up again because it gives you a clean slate to work on. So let's refresh. We're still getting that. Is it because I've gone and messed up the Nginx? I think I might have done that. Nginx.conf, etc. That is right. That's what we've just done. Let's go back to the homepage. Ah, hang on a minute. Is it because I've now have to do the whole installation again? Okay. Damn. Let me see if I can get a reverse search of the... Well, first of all, Docker PS-A. What's running? They're all up. Docker logs. This is the upstream again, is it? Upstream. Failed, connection refused whilst connecting to upstream. What? The Magento pane. Why has that changed? Why has that changed? We've just... Hang on a minute, something's not right. Spin through all this again. Right. So. Why? Have I messed up the configuration? That looks fine. Nginx.conf goes to etc nginx default.conf. So let's go back onto the box and see if that actually was set. So let's go back to nginx1sh. No, that's not the right. Sorry, Docker. Compose Nginx. That is the right, Nginx and sh. And we need to do it through exec, of course. Cd etc nginx ls cd conf.d ls cat of default. Scroll up to the top here. Okay, that's set. Okay. Got the resolver in here. So nothing has actually technically changed. And yet now the site's down. That's now... This is very strange. Now it's coming back up again. What? Right, if that's coming back up again, we've turned off debug, so that's set to zero. Still taking time, isn't it? This doesn't feel right. Okay, we got the shop back. I can see it here. We still have debug on. Although that's gone straight down. Let's refresh again. That's taking much too long. All right, let's see if we can get into the admin and just have a noodle. If it gets too painful, I'll put it in prod mode. Come on, right. Just wow. Seriously, am I going to be allowed in? Right. Okay. Cool. Right, so what do I need to look for? I want to see if there's a way of limiting the delivery to a certain country. So that's the first thing I want to check for. So I want to make sure that's the case. So when I go and create a product, so if we go products, oh dear. Deary me. I think I'm going to put this in prod. I think I'm going to put this in prod. Yeah, I think I'm going to do that because this is getting painful. I'm not the most patient person in the world. No doubt. Oh, okay. So we've got a configurable product and a simple product. What's a simple product? Let's create a simple product. Yay. All right. Enough is enough. Let's see if we can get this into prod mode because this is getting very painful. This might have a whole bunch of issues with it. All right, so bear with me a minute. Mm-hmm. It's not giving me confidence for developing it, to be honest. I mean, I might be able to tinker with the actual dev box, the VM that we're using, which is the Docker machine, to give it some more juice. Anyway, so what have I done? I've just set that to prod. So let's do Docker compose. We'll do down. Bring them down again. And then we'll do an up. All right. Now. This was having some problems before with, okay, this is a simple product. Let's just, first of all, make sure that we can get back to the homepage. That's probably the best starting point, right? Whilst that's doing its refresh, let's have a look at this page. So we can add, this is the simple product, right? So there's a variant product here. So you can add a price, you can add the original price as well. You can add different channels, so I need to configure the channels too. Then what can we do? The name, the slug, and the description. Keywords, some SEO stuff here. Put in some language translations, which is nice, I think. Right, okay, so this is name, slug, and description for different languages. Nice, okay, right, we've just gone back to the homepage, and we should be running in prod mode, which should be fast. Let's hit refresh. Is it fast? Yes, it's faster. I wouldn't say it's fast, but it's certainly faster. If we went to t-shirts men, come on. Don't let me down. There we go. Let's see. Let's go through an order. Oh, I'm regretting pressing that button. Come on. Come on. Come on, you can do it. There we go. Okay, so these are t-shirts, and you can purchase, it looks like, different sizes and quantities. And then here we got attributes and reviews. So obviously for my clients, this will be totally different. We'll have details. We probably won't have these tabs, but you know, attributes doesn't sound right. Hello, for what coders. I need. Reviews, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. Let's see if we can add it to the basket. I'm not sure what that is. Just random shop basic white t-shirt. I don't know what that means. So let's add one of those. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Okay, so that's now gone to somewhere, has it? There we go, right. So item, so this is nice. I like this. So we've broken down the items total, the shipping cost, and taxes as well. So I'm assuming all of this is configurable. We can have coupons. That's a nice touch. That's good. So let's go ahead and check out. So billing, this is nice. Billing address. What's that? Oh, nice. So you can have a different shipping address to a billing address. Some details for contact. Okay. Okay, okay, I like it, I like it, I like it. The speed thing I could probably get around through just technical changes, okay? So I'm not seriously marking it down for that. You know, it's gonna be very different for different boxes, different servers and stuff. So I can knock my servers together and put some caching behind it and all that stuff. So we can work around speed. I'm more worried at the moment because you know, I obviously can't talk about what the clients need, but in terms of, like, I can't show you what they're selling, of course, but what I can do is I can go through some of the technical requirements. So one thing is that they need to be able to limit the, or some of them at least need to limit the delivery. So we need to make sure that that can happen. And also stock, adjusting stock. You do need to have an okay speed when developing. Definitely, definitely, sure, definitely. Yeah. So, yeah. But this is running off of a Docker machine, which hasn't been, there's been no memory bump to that. It's just a standard Docker machine. So I could hack that and give it some more juice. So yeah, I've literally just installed Silas. I'm just playing around with it. So let's go and see the back end. So let's go to admin. Because again, there's some things that I need to just tinker with and make sure things work. And actually, I am quite impressed out of the box. The speed is an issue, but one I can probably get around. Okay, so this is the dashboard. That looks fine. I mean, I mean, that actually looks really, really good. It's exactly what we need. So that's good. But what I'm interested in is, can I create another product that, can I do create product? There's a simple product here. Can I create a product that is limited to a specific delivery? So we've got, that's the SKU, I would imagine. Is shipping required? Yes. This is the default channel that we've created. Associations, media, inventory. Excellent. So we can change the stock levels. That's cool. And we can say that it's tracked. I don't really know what that means, but awesome. Okay, so we have stock control. That's a big tick. All right. So this is the translations, and then we have shipping. Shipping category is not a requirement. Well, it is. Width, height, depth, and weight. Shipping category. Okay, category of shipping. Gotcha. Gotcha, gotcha, gotcha. So let's go to shipments. Oh, these are in sales. I see. Okay. So, fine. Is there a way I can... here, a whole bunch of configuration options. So I want to see if there's a way of creating the zones and countries. So, right. So you disable countries and you enable countries, it looks like. So at the moment, let's spin this up on another tab, which is here. At the moment, it looks like if I go to checkout, I think it's giving me the selection of, of these places. But really, I just want, for just testing purposes, I just want one place. So does this mean then I can disable these? Can I do it en masse? That would be really cool. No, okay. So let's see if I can disable Australia. Save. Does this mean that Australia is now removed from this list? So Australia's there if I was to refresh. Yes, sweet. Okay, so we can disable countries. Again, that's another big tick. Let's, can I go back to countries? It would be nice if there was a way, and I mean, this is just a, this is just me being really nitpicky now. It looks like I can, it would be nice to have a way of like just marking all of these as disabled. Yeah, shipping, this is what I need to do. I need to only allow certain shipping. We're going to disable all of them apart from the UK. So we're going to grab, save that, and then have to go back. It's a little bit of leg room. Disable that. And then a little bit of leg work. I mean, Germany. Disable that. And Spain. This is managing shipping destinations. So this isn't preventing people from accessing the site from these countries. This is just preventing people from ordering from these countries, which is what I need. So we're going to disable Mexico. And we're going to disable New Zealand. I mean, really, to be honest, This is just going to come back with one single select box, which will just have one option in it, which is actually really bad UI. If thinking about this through. So I think that, and then disable the US. So I think what I need to do instead, when it comes to it, is to what? There's nothing in there. Hang on, have I got rid of the UK? The UK is in there, but it can't. Does it know that? That's strange. I don't know what's going on there. Why is that? Okay. use a different address for shipping, and then down here, yeah, it's still nothing. Okay, that's a bit weird. But anyway, what I'm saying is that as there's only one option anyway, we're going to need this whole selection process is non-existent because there's no selection. It would just be the UK. So what I would need to do is actually make sure that the postcodes are valid for the UK. So let's go and have a look at and the cities, if there's a way of doing such a thing. So we've got, if I edit the UK, I can add a province, code provinces, because here we've got postcode and city, and then in zones, what's in zones? Aha, US and the world. Let's edit the world. Members. For some reason, it's because I've disabled all countries apart from the UK. I can't. Let's see if I can enable Portugal. For some reason, it's not populating the select. So I've enabled Portugal. So let's refresh this. And so we got Portugal, but we don't have the UK. The UK is empty for some reason. I don't know why. That's strange. Locales. So we got ENUS for United States. Okay, so these are the different locales that I use. That's cool. I don't think we need any of these, to be honest. It's just for what I need right now. Maybe later. Shipping categories. I'm confused as to why this is empty. Like, what's with that? Strange. Yes, but the requirement is that some of the clients don't want that. They just want to be shipping to one place. There was an empty row before too. Maybe it's a value problem. Tyrion is mentioning. Yeah. Okay, let's overlook that for a minute. Ah, the name is empty here. The name's empty. Why is the name empty? Why is the name for the UK empty? What's going on? That's not good. What? That doesn't make any. And I can't select it. I can't do anything. Okay. Let's edit Portugal. So Portugal is there, but it's disabled. So this is obviously coming from somewhere, but I don't know where. They've missed the UK. it could be sample data. Yes. Yeah. Very true. Very true. I guess what I would need to do then, sort of the next phase of this, once I've discovered if this is a viable option, is to then create my own sample data specifically for what I need, which will disable and enable various settings and stuff. So we'll overlook that, and we'll call that an issue with sample data. I think that's probably the correct thing. Payment methods. This is an important one. Let's have a look at this. So cash on delivery, bank transfer. Okay, let's hit create. Let's do PayPal Express or Stripe checkout. No CA support. Huh. All right, let's try Stripe. The chosen payment gateway does not support SCA, not CA. Yeah, SCA. But it looks like, so you put in your code, your publishable keys and your secrets here. This is okay. This is good for Stripe. Let's take a look for PayPal Express here. Standard stuff, so you can switch between sandbox mode or not. You can put in your username, password, and signatures, and then put in some instructions. Okay, so that's quite nice that it comes out of the box like that. That's good. I don't have to install any plugins for those two things, which is nice. So, okay, what have we learned so far? On products, I can create a product. Let's go ahead and create a product. Let's create a product. So let's do code of test, price of, make up a price, $12.50, right? Original price is $12.50. The name is test product one. How imaginative is this? Test product one. Description is, this is a test. We won't worry about any of that, I don't think. Shipping is shipping category. Why is this saying not a requirement? It is a requirement to ship. Unless this is asking for taxes, clothing, or other. We'll do other. And then, right, let's hit create. I'm not sure what shipping means here. I don't know what that is. I'm sure there's documentation. I've literally just gone from the installation guide to straight into it. So I do need to review the documentation. Manage variants. Show product in shop page. So this is disabled for some reason. This is disabled. So it's almost like it's not available yet. Oh, do I need to put in channels? So channels being the fashion web store. So let's hit save again. There, now I can see it. Okay, so I had to select the channels. So let's hit this and now I have this error. Okay. Oh, it's running off of localhost. Aha, I see. Right, let's copy that string. Let's go back to here. And let's paste that into there. Okay, so we've got our test product one. It's $12, quantity of one. This is a test. It has no reviews. The image is a default image. Cool. Okay, so taxonomy. So we can put it in different categories, attributes, Add an attribute, Germany. I'm not sure what that means yet. Associations, so you can associate it with other products. So let's associate this with all of this stuff. Let's hit save. Does that change the display? Associations are nice, I like that. It's a good touch. Yeah, here we go, similar products. Sweet, okay, that's what I wanted. That's nice, out of the box. Good. Media, I'm assuming, is like images and stuff. Okay, current stock is zero. Does that mean, what does that mean? Like, can I, it's current stock is zero, but can I add this to my basket? Yeah, I can. So if we were to delete it from the basket, and then maybe go back to here, right? Can I do tracked and then hit save? Does this now track this? And does this now say that there's zero in stock? So this is unavailable. So let's refresh. Out of stock, that's exactly what I need. Oh, this is great stuff. This is great stuff. So I used this Silas. I used this about 3 years ago, and it was so, like, nowhere near as good as this. Because it was, before it was in version one, it was like in not even beta phase, it was, they were still developing it. Wow, that's, I'm blown away by that. Excellent stuff. I really like these with similar products. And the reviews. How do the reviews work? So add your own review. Write your own review. So this is a good product. I don't know. Hello world. Add. Oh, I must put in a rating, and we need to put in test@foo.com. Okay, your review is waiting for okay, so I need to accept the review. So if we go back to the here, let's go back to the homepage. Do I have any reviews? What's this? There is a new version of Silas available. Contact your technician to upgrade. Good. Good. Let's see if I can disable this. Otherwise I'll have phone calls. No, let's not do that because that would be silly. I've just created a review. So is there a way I can see that review coming in? So new customers, test.foo is a guest. So not actually a customer yet. What does guest mean? Show. What does that do? So I'm going off into different tangents here. Subscribe to the new, hasn't subscribed to the, so it's got a newsletter, that's cool. This customer has not completed any orders yet, so it's just the user on here, test.foo. All right. Right, so go back to the homepage. There's nothing indicating that there is any review to be accepted. So, do I go into product reviews? This is a good product. Okay, so I can. So, I should say that this is tiny because of the stream. This is a tiny window that I'm running in, so it does look a bit cut off here. So, I can accept, I can reject, I can delete, I can edit. Seriously? This is cool. So I can manually change. Oh, nice. Okay. All right. I think they'll like that. I think they'll like that. Okay. Okay. I like that a lot. Okay. So if we hit cancel, can I accept it? What happens? So it says it's accepted. And it originally had 2 reviews. If we refresh, now it has 3 reviews and it's gone up a star. So we hit 3 reviews. Hello world. That's nice. I like it. So we've got, so the URL here is the locale, then products, and then the name of the product, and then / reviews, which is nice. I like that. Okay. So far, so good. So far, so good. I'm assuming I can change all of this stuff. Can I do any other layout stuff through the CMS? I don't want to, but I want to see if that's available. I don't want to do any of that. I want to do all of that through Twig templates, but payment methods, shipping categories. It doesn't look like I can. Channels would be like multi stores, I think, or channels of stores. So that we're running off of the fashion web, but it doesn't. I can't seem to update any of the sort of like the footer or anything, which is exactly what I want. I don't want any of my clients to control that. So we can change the catalog and the sales. We can see the customers. So let's have a look at those. So that was the test foo guest. And I'm assuming that's happened because I've created a review. Okay. So what's verified? No. Does this mean that they get a link in an email and they have to verify it, perhaps? So let's hit show orders on this one. So I can see previous orders that they've created. That's awaiting payment. So we have, so this is all sample data. So we've got telephone number, we've got email address, we've got the customer date, billing addresses, it's awaiting payment, shipping bits and pieces. Press the button. Okay, so shipment has been successfully updated. So it's now being shipped through DHL Express. Okay, we'll take a look at that in just a second, how that gets configured. And then history. So we have history of the customer, billing address, action. So we can see when they were logged in, the changes that they made. This is nice. All right, cool. Okay, so one thing that caught my eye is the ability to have this DHL Express. How do I do that? Would that be in shipping methods? Yeah, all right, so shipping methods, DHL Express world. So can I create? So I guess that's like an internal code. You have the zone position. I don't know what that means. You can disable it. The different channels. And then you can apply like taxes against the shipping. And then you can put in an amount for the shipping. That's nice. That's nice. Okay, I like that. Yeah, so far, so good. Groups, what's groups? Yeah, let's leave that. customer groups. So I can have retail groups, wholesale groups. I don't think I need to worry about that too much. So, meh. Promotions, this will be an interesting one. So different promotions. So let's create a promotion. Somewhere I would imagine there is a discount code, maybe. So we have code, name, description, configuration, add rules. So, okay. So put in different quantity of the cart, and then you could have, so let's say, for example, I wanted to put in 4 and an action, order fixed discount, order percentage discount, item percentages discount, or shipping. Let's say I want to give a discount of, is this percentage or fixed rate? I think it's fixed rate. So let's say $5, right? Let's put in foo. And this is for QTY. So this is get, what did I say? $5. $5 off when purchasing 4 or more products. Usage limit. Okay, so you can do it through that's interesting. So let's leave that empty. Priority, I don't know what that is. Channels is definitely the fashion store. Coupon based. Exclusive. And start and end dates. So let's start it here. And this is time. So that's fine. Let's see if I can create that. Okay, what's the errors? Okay, I do need time. Can I just do that? Is that gonna work? I just want something to play with. Come on. All right, so the promotion has been activated. Notice though, I can't seem to put the promotion on a specific product, or can I? Customer group, shipping country, has at least one from Taxons. Okay, right, so yeah, I can do it by Taxon, which is categorization. Contains product, here we go, contains a product. So I only want this for my test product, which I think I called it just test. Yeah, test product one. There we go. Okay, now hit save. This is what I'm after. This is what I need. Good, good, good. So this will apparently give me $5 off if I was to purchase this product. Can I add a rule? So can I actually make it so it needs to be this product, and there needs to be 4 in this product. Let's hit save. So you need to have this product and you need 4 of them and you get $5 off. Right, let's see if I can do that. So from here, let's see if there's a way of finding that test product. Here we go, click on that. Oh, I need to put it back into stock again, don't I? So that would be in products. And we're gonna look for, can I search for a product here? Filters, search, contains, value, test, filter. There we go. Edit. Let's go to inventory and change that to be 10. So 10, oops. What's happened there? Did that go in this 10? Yeah, cool. So let's go and refresh this page. This should now be in stock. So if I add 1, it should be $12.50. Right, $12.50. If I was to add for an update. Does that indicate that there's any discount? Yes, discount, $5. Excellent. Okay, this is good stuff. This is exactly what I need. Let's get rid of this one. I don't want to work on that one at the moment. Whoops. What do you mean it doesn't exist? What's going on? I clicked the X button. Okay, there's a bug there. I can't remove that from the cart. I think what I'm going to need to do is create some BHAT tests for this to just make sure that it does exactly what I want it to do. I mean, it's not going to look like this at all. Definitely not. But it will have the functionality. But that's cool. I can have a discount of $5 on that. Yeah. All right. Cool. Cool. I suppose I should get back to the documentation because we've got to this bit here and we've completely taken it, gone away from the documentation because we installed it with Docker. Yada, yada, yada. Right. Whoops. So this is now explaining the channels. I really should have gone through all of this, to be honest. But you know, I'm impatient. So zone, the last configuration step is creating a zone. They are used for various reasons like shipping and taxing operations and can consist of countries, provinces, and other zones. You can have a zone in the zone. Okay. So I definitely recommend going through this documentation. Okay, new shipping method. So this is a FedEx example. And then here is payment. So you can add different payment things. So you could, if you were to do a website for a delivery company that was to deliver, say, takeaway, then you could do cash on demand, cash on delivery, sorry, or through PayPal or Stripe or what have you. Okay, let's hit next. So then this is an example of creating the first product. And hit next again. Okay, so you can start with the shop panel. Shop customizations. What makes Silas unique from other e-commerce systems is that it's highly developed community or clean code base. The developer experience has always been, okay, you can start with the shop panel. Customizing templates chapter. Okay, I'll have a look at that in just a second. Default logo for the shop panel is there. The first step to detect which template is responsible for displaying the logo and therefore which should be overridden is it's placed in the Silas shop bundle at... Okay, yes, great stuff. This is what I want to do. Change the templates. Okay. This is good. This is talking about a custom shipping calculator. Plugin installation. So it has plugins. It's easy to customize for your business needs, but not all of the customizations you have to do on your own. I don't think I need to worry about that too much. Yeah. Awesome. Let's go back to, there was a bit there about customizing Twig. Here we go. Customizing templates. Methods of customizing of template customization. There are three ways to customizing templates. The first one is overriding templates inside the templates bundle of the project. Let's go and check that out. Where is that? Go into the code here. Templates. here, bundles, twig bundle exception. All right, so you would create your override your twig templates through here. So you would have to look at whether on SRC, which controller, is that right? No, that doesn't make any sense. Migrations, entity, maybe, no, it's not in there. Wherever it is, I don't know where it is. It might be, oh, it would be in the vendor, of course. Of course it would be, silly me. Yeah, so it would be in vendor and then Silas. Here we go. Might be the theme. Anyway, let's get back to the documentation. So, using this method can completely change the content of templates. The second method is customizing via events. Okay, you are able to listen on these template events and add your own blocks without copying and pasting the whole template. This feature is really useful when creating Silas plugins. I don't think I'm going to be doing any of that yet, so I'm not sure I need to worry about that, but that's cool that you can do that. The third method is using Silas themes. Okay, creating a Silas theme requires a few more steps than basic template overriding. I can see a future stream coming on here where we're actually building a theme. Creating Silas theme requires a few more steps than basic template overriding, but allows you to have different designs on multiple channels. Interesting. Okay, so this is how you would override a theme. Sorry, override a template. How do you know which template you should be overriding? Go to the page you are going to modify at the bottom of the Symfony toolbar on the root. Okay, so you do need to do this in development mode, obviously. And then you would find the template through the dev web toolbar. You can check the path of the current template. The default login template is Silas Shop Bundle login. In order to override, if you need to create your own, then you would do templates, bundles, shop, Silas shop bundle, login.html. Copy the contents of the original template to make your life a little easier, and then modify it. Uh-huh, okay. And then you run the cache clear. And you can also change the admin templates as well. Okay, this is now customizing via events. I don't think I need to worry about that at this stage. Don't need to worry about that. Global twig temp variables. That's good to know. I just want to have a little noodle and see about these themes. So themes, what's this all about? Okay, there are some criteria that that you have to analyze before choosing either a standard Symfony template overriding or themes. This is good documentation. I like this. When you should choose a standard template overriding, you only have one channel, or you do not need different looks themes on each of your channels. You need only basic changes in the views, changing colors, some blocks, and rearranging. So I don't need multiple channels, I don't think. So I only have one channel to start with. So I might just use template overriding. When should you use Silas themes? You have more than one channel for a single Silas instance, and you want each of these channels to have their own look and behavior. You change a lot of things in the views. So I'm probably going to be having a lot of changes because, I mean, I like this layout, but it's not what I need. And there's going to probably be some fancy, if I go to the homepage, for instance, I definitely know that this carousel is probably going to need to go at the top here, and it's going to look different to this, and I'm not sure about this header image, you know, the placement of this, nor am I, I don't think that this whole header thing is it will work for what I need, and the footer here is just going to be totally different, and this about us section probably will be higher up, and it will be probably full width rather than this, and there might be some animations and other bits and pieces going on. So I don't think that this out of the box is what I need, and to be honest, it shouldn't be, you know, you shouldn't just use things out of the box. I don't think the we might put the title and the price above and put the price slightly bigger or something. I don't know yet. But it's not going to be like this. There's going to be a lot of changes. That's basically what I'm trying to say. Which is why I was considering maybe using themes over just template overriding. Oops, where's that? But it's saying if you have more than one channel for a single Silas instance, and I don't think I will. I think I'll only have the one. And you want each channel to have their own look and behavior. Again, no need for that. But then here, you change a lot of things in the views. So that there's still an open question. I guess it depends on how much change I do. Okay, so how to enable themes in a project. So you enable the theme in the in config, so silastheme.yaml. How to create a theme. So inside the themes directory, there is a new directory for your theme. So put that in. So let's have a look. Do we have a theme already in here? So if I go into themes... No, there's no theme yet, which is a shame because there's nothing I can copy from. Okay, let it be Crimson theme, for instance. Create composer.json for your theme. Okay, this is interesting. Install the theme assets. Okay, customize the template in order to customize login view. Right. Oh, I see. Okay, so you import the templates into your theme, but you can have more than one theme for more than one channel. Right, that makes sense. Okay, and then you can... Right, and then you can choose your theme through configuration. See, I don't think I need to go that far. I would love to, like from a technical standpoint, but I don't think I need to. It really depends on how much change, I think. Well, this has certainly opened my eyes to the possibilities, definitely. Let's have a look at registration. Yeah, so that this is going to be different. A verification that would come through an email, I suppose. And then you can... Interesting. Good. I like it. What's options? I'm clicking about now. Okay, so these are the various different options. So I don't think I need a lot of this stuff, to be honest, the options, not for the start. I might do later on, but for the start, I don't think there's going to be many options. It's going to be mostly one-off things, I think, that have stock. Okay, cool. Well, I need to get some breakfast because I'm starving. I've been up since 7 doing this. But we've got Silas running in Docker. It's installed, running off of the sample data. And I'm, you know, color me impressed, I think. Because I think this could be worth a shot, I think. Cool. Anyway, I'm going to crack on with the rest of my day, but thank you ever so much, everybody, for joining. I do appreciate it. Happy coding, everybody. And make sure to check out the Code School on Thursday nights. So Code School, I haven't mentioned it yet, is it's a beginner friendly stream where I teach HTML and CSS and JavaScript. And I think what I'm going to do in the next stream is teach a little bit of CSS. We've been building a HTML form. So if you're new to CSS, then come and join. That's on Thursday evening at 2100 hours BST. I'm in the UK. I will let everybody know on the Discord server closer to the time. But thank you very much. I'm going to get a cup of tea, another one, and some breakfast, and then continue on with the rest of my day. Thank you ever so much for joining. Happy coding, everybody. I'll see you again soon. Cheers. Bye.